Greetings to you all. I was always very curious to see what was going on inside a multimedia projector. Lucky me, I got my hands on this Epson free LCD projector. This won't be a full teardown like I usually do, as it's a very complicated device and I wasn't sure I would be able to put it back together after a complete teardown. On top of that, I had no paperwork of any kind I could rely on, so it was a lot of guessing during the whole process. Before I start, I'd like to encourage you to subscribe to this channel, follow me on Instagram, or even consider supporting future videos on Patreon. All links are included in the description. Great, this is an Epson EB-G6550WU 3 LCD projector. There are a few different types of projectors that look different inside, for example DLP or laser light source. This projector in particular implements 3 LCD technology, which means that there is a separate liquid crystal display for each of three colors. As I have mentioned before, I don't have any paperwork and I have no idea which screw I should undo first to open it up. First of all, I will get rid of the parts which I can detach fairly easily. I will start with the lens. In order to remove it, I just have to press the release button and turn the lens anti-clockwise. This is a non-motorized lens, which means that you have to adjust the focus and zoom manually. Next, I will remove the lamp. I will undo these two screws to access it. In order to keep the door out of the way, I will detach it by releasing this plastic clip. Great! After undoing two security screws, the lamp itself can be extracted. This is an ultra-high efficiency mercury lamp. Its power consumption is 380 watts and it's designed to operate 2400 hours in normal mode and up to 3900 hours in eco mode. Alright, I will remove the dust filter and the filter hatch. I just have to pry the hinge on the right hand side and it's done. My guess is that I might be able to remove the front panel next. Let's see if this is the case. Let's remove this cap first, then undo six screws which are securing the front panel at the bottom of the unit, and finally remove two more screws which are hiding behind the inner cap. After a closer examination, I have realized that the top cover of the unit must be removed first. This means that I have to undo 13 screws that hold the top and the bottom of the projector together. I will flip it over and give it a little shake to rattle all these screws out so they won't go missing later. That's not all. There are two more screws behind the lamp hatch and another two behind the filter door. This wireless connection USB dongle holder also has to be removed. Even after removing all these screws, the top cover didn't want to give up. I decided to remove all seven screws at the rear panel. However, I only needed to unscrew three of them. It just proves that you can never be sure which screws to undo when you are not familiar with the unit and there is no service manual. Oh boy, it's a very densely populated unit. Hopefully I'll be able to put it back together. As I have already unscrewed all the screws that were securing the rear panel, I will remove it next. I only have to disconnect this tiny ribbon cable, which links the main board with this small control panel at the rear of the unit. Great, that wasn't very painful. The only part that can be easily removed at this stage is this fan. After disconnecting it from the main PCB and undoing three screws, it can be extracted fairly easily. I have already removed all the screws which are securing the front panel except these two inner ones. Before removing the panel itself, I have to disconnect another ribbon cable which links the main board with a tiny PCB mounted on it. This PCB controls status LEDs as well as AR receiver. Here we go, the front panel is now separated from the projector. In order to remove the main PCB, I have to disconnect every single cable connected to it. To eliminate any mistakes, I will put tags on every cable as I go. These cables are thermal sensors and fans mostly. However, this cable here powers up a motor, which moves mechanical brightness adjustment curtains. You will see how it looks a bit later. These two shielded ribbon cables provide a link between the main and a 3 LCD control PCB. This is another pair of fan and thermal sensor connectors. This 12-pin connector links the main PCB with the power supply unit. Now I'm disconnecting an internal speaker cable. A few more fans and sensors. I did not expect to see so many fans inside this projector. I will try to count how many of them are there in total at the end of this video. This is an additional IR receiver, which is located at the rear of the unit. Next, I will undo three screws which are securing HDMI, DisplayPort and S-video sockets. I think it's time to remove 9 screws which are securing the main board itself. Unfortunately, there is more screws to undo, I just don't know where they are. Let's see if removing all remaining screws at the rear will help. Another 11 screws are out and yet the main PCB doesn't want to give up. Hopefully, if I undo these 3 screws that secure the rear frame and one more screw at the top, I will finally be able to extract it. Great success! It appears that it's not just one PCB, but in fact it's a 3-board ASI. I will take this ASI apart and try to find out what are the functions of each of these 3 boards. I believe that this board is responsible for control functions of the projector, including the wireless control. This little board has 5 BNC connectors, which can be used either for RGB or component signals. You can also see an old-school VGA connector, 3 3.5mm jack audio inputs, RS232 port for unit control, another VGA port which works as a monitor output accompanied by 3.5mm jack audio output. Another 3.5mm jack dedicated for remote control and a pair of analog RCA inputs which are paired with composite and S-video inputs located on the main board. And finally, let's have a look at the main PCB. Here on this board you can see composite and S-video inputs as well as DisplayPort, HDMI, Ethernet and service USB port. At the top side of the PCB you can see 2 main chips. One of them is a single chip enhanced LCD monitor controller made by ST Microelectronics. Its name suggests that you can also find it inside liquid crystal displays. And the second chip, which is made by Epson, is a processor slash microcontroller. On the other side of the board there is one more chip which is made by Renesas and it's a dual channel triple 10-bit LVDS transmitter, which is designed to support pixel data transmission between a video processing engine and a digital video display. Perfect, now as the main PCB ASI is successfully extracted, it's time to dig out the board which controls 3 LCDs. But first I will get rid of this USB extension cable, which links wireless control dongle with the main PCB. And of course I need to disconnect all the cables before I can proceed with the board extraction. Next operation is going to be very delicate. These three white ribbon cables are linking this PCB with three LCDs. I am using my plastic prying tool to unclip cable holders and carefully extract the cables themselves. I will insulate the tips of the ribbon cables with PVC tape. This will prevent any LCD from getting any damage from statics. Each LCD is responsible for its own color. First one is red, second is green, and the last one is blue. Alright, let's undo these six screws and extract the PCB. On this board you can see Pixelworks Motion Engine Video Processor, connectors for three LCDs and a mysterious chip on the other side of the board, which I was not able to identify apart from that it is manufactured by Epson. But then I spotted these four smaller Samsung 512 MB RAM chips. Now I can say it's very likely that it's some kind of GPU. Sorry that I was not able to give you more information on these boards. I wish I would have the service manual, which usually helps me to understand how the unit works. Not many things are intuitive here. I had to look very closely to find out which part to extract next and how should I do that. This fan hood was one of the easiest parts to extract, as it was only fixed with three screws which were clearly visible. The fan itself was not attached anywhere. It was simply suspended on these orange rubber dampers. The front grille came out relatively easy too. Great! I think now it's a very good moment to demonstrate to you the lens shift mechanism. It is not very noticeable during the normal use, but if I speed the video up, you can clearly see how the lens moves relatively to the light beam, and at the same time the projected image would be shifting vertically or horizontally. I will crack on and remove more parts which I was able to find. It looks like the lamp hood can be removed without too much struggle. Next goes the mechanical dimmer. It can reduce the brightness of the projected image. Stepper motor brings these doors closer together, which limits the amount of lights which gets through the projector, and that reduces the brightness. Main flaw of this solution is that energy is wasted and it doesn't help to prolong the lifetime of the lamp. Lamp heat shield is extracted too. I was really surprised to find out that 3LCD ASI was only held by two tiny screws, and the extraction process was way easier than I expected. Here we go, that's the 3LCD ASI. It includes a lens slot, lens shift mechanism, 3 LCDs, and a light summing prism. Great, let's come back and see what else I can extract. It looks like the top part of this duct can come out next. 10 screws undone, a little bit of effort applied, and the top cover... hold on, I forgot to disconnect the ground bus cable. Here we go. Now the top cover is finally extracted. As you can see, two fans are sitting inside this duct. As you have probably spotted, they are completely clean. The air filter, which I removed at the beginning of this video, prevents the dust from getting into this part of the projector. It is crucial to keep this part dust-free, as these fans are cooling the LCDs. Finally, I'm getting closer to the most exciting part of the projector, and in a few moments you will understand why. But first, let's take a quick look at the power supply. I have decided not to extract it, as in my opinion, it is not worth the effort. Even without extracting it, you can see that it's located at the back of the unit and also it's enclosed inside the ducting. This solution helps to ensure that heat produced by PSU is extracted efficiently. From what I see without disassembling the ducting around the PSU, there are two PCBs here. On the left-hand side, there is a power supply that feeds all electronic components of the projector. And here on the right is a ballast for the high-pressure mercury lamp. Let's come back to the part of the projector where the light beam gets split into three. I'm going to move the thermal sensor out of the way and undo 7 screws. This will allow me to lift the top part without too much effort. There are some kind of filters attached to the top cover. If you know what they are, please let me know in the comments, as I was not able to find any information about them. Here we go, now you can see the most exciting part of this projector. Here, with the help of a set of various lenses and mirrors, a single white light beam gets split into red, green and blue beams. After the light beam is properly focused, it hits the first dichroic mirror, which splits it into blue and yellow beams. The blue beam is redirected into a blue LCD with the help of a few lenses and the ordinary mirror, while the yellow beam reaches a second dichroic mirror, which splits it into green and red beams. It might be hard to imagine, so let me demonstrate it to you. I will now use my head torch as a light source, as it's not possible to power up the main lamp while the projector is disassembled. Okay, let me switch the lights off and voila! I did not expect that it was going to look so cool, really. I think it's a pretty good visual aid that will help understand what is going on inside a multimedia projector. Great! I really hope that you enjoyed watching this video or maybe even found it useful. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, as this helps more people to discover my videos. Thank you very much for your attention and I'll see you soon. Goodbye!